Thank you very much for coming to my talk. I'm Zoltan Nemeth. I work for Ustream, which is now an IBM company. A bit more of about that in the coming minutes. And I'm here to talk about scalability and how we learned it and how we try to do it these days. So a little bit about Ustream. How many of you are familiar with Ustream? Just a quick check. Okay, some of you. So we do live streaming video. The company was founded in 2007 by two Americans and a Hungarian. It started up as a free streaming service supported by advertisements, just like YouTube did with recorded video at those times. We did it for live. But later on, we gradually transitioned into a different market. So now we focus on selling live streaming and video on demand services for enterprises and professional broadcasters. The company has been recently acquired by IBM. So this happened in this January. We are a part of IBM Cloud Video Unit now. This changed nothing in terms of the company, but we can grow. So by the way, we are hiring. That's enough about the advertisement part. What's important here is that we have a quite complex technology stack. So in order to do live streaming, you need to have all sorts of different application services. Basic illustration of the streaming flow can be seen here. It's very, very oversimplified, but you get the idea. So after registering on the website and purchasing a package or starting the free broadcast, the broadcaster needs to connect to a service we call Ustream Media Server. This does the business logic of the streaming stack. Basically, the broadcaster communicates with this service on WebSocket or RTMP protocols. This service does the authentication, some initial verifications, load balancing, and all that stuff, and takes all the necessary subscription data from the central database, which is filled by the website, and there's a remote gateway interface sort of API in between. And then the broadcaster will receive an RTMP address for an ingest server. He needs to connect there and push the stream via RTMP. This is the same as everybody does on the market, I guess. So I think this is, talk is streamed on YouTube. So YouTube also accepts RTMP ingest. That's what everyone does. And then we have a real-time transcoding cluster, which is basically coordinated by the UMS logic service. It takes the raw feed from the ingest server and then converts it in real time to different bit rates, resolutions, codecs, and pushes it back, the new versions, to the ingest server. And the ingest server then generates small video chunks, small files. And these files that can be delivered to the viewers. So on the other side, the viewer comes, opens up the Ustream player on some web page. This means he fires up a connection to the same UMS service where he receives a bunch of URLs where he needs to download the video content from. This is likely pointing to some CDN or one of our edges which serve the chunks generated by the ingest server. That's the basic. A lot of services are missing from here. And just to illustrate how oversimplified this is, you see the transcoding cluster up there. If I chart up the transcoding cluster, it looks like something like this. this is intentionally blurred because it's IBM intellectual property right now. So, but you get the idea. So you have dozens of components in any component, and if you dig even further down, then there's again some more components. So I wanted to just to show this, to illustrate how complex our stack is. Now, just jump a little bit back in time, back to 2009, where we were a small startup at that time. The company was less than 2 years old. The technology was like not very well matured. And then this thing happened. You know this guy? I'm not surprised if you don't, but he's very popular with teenagers. And so he posted this stuff on Twitter that he's live on Ustream right now, and their fans should come and check it out. Wow. It hit us hard. It was a peak in viewership and everything like this. So we just weren't prepared. Everything went down, crashing, and we spent hours restoring the service. Then came a few other events, like there was the earthquake in Japan. I'm not sure if you heard about it, but there was a story that after the Fukushima tsunami, people started broadcasting on Ustream, and the Apple store in Tokyo stayed open until late at night and put big screens in front of the store so that people could watch the broadcasts and get some news from the region, because there was no official news coming out. So that was the only way to find out what's going on. And then there was the protests all over the world in the recent years. I'm sure you heard about them in the news. Those are also events like you cannot prepare for. Then there was a couple of events that we knew they were coming, but we didn't exactly knew their size. This was like the PS4 launch, which Sony broadcasted on Ustream. And we tried our best to prepare to it, but still, it was a near miss. And then there was SpaceX launches, and sometimes NASA broadcasts asteroids as they approach the Earth, and people start watching and commenting that, oh, wow, this is gonna hit us, and stuff like that. And of course, the greatest one of all that is the El Clasico. You know that? Real Madrid versus Barcelona. That's the absolute top in viewership on the internet. So all this adds up to a pattern like this, where you have the regular traffic, and then you have the peaks. So this is a 30-day viewer number graph, by the way. So yeah, we must scale to adapt to all this. This is the conclusion of the history lesson. On the delivery side, we solved it by using CDNs, actually not one, but many of them, combining them together and adding some our own capacity. I could do another talk about that at some other time. That's quite complex, but I won't go into details now, because now I want to speak about scaling the application side. So let's just quickly do some scalability theory first. How do you define scalability? That's the beginning of every theory. So I got two definitions here. One is from a university paper from Carnegie Mellon University from 2006. So you see that this concept is not very old, like 10 years now. So it says, scalability is the ability to handle increased workload by repeatedly applying a cost-effective strategy for extending a system's capacity. The key words here are cost-effective. So you spend the same amount of money and you get the same amount of capacity. But there's an even more well-versed definition here, coming from Theo Schlossnagel, the man who was one of the greatest theoretics of scalability, and he does it in practice also. So he says that scalability is how well a solution to some problem will work when the size of the problem increases. And also, when the size decreases, the solution must fit. This second part is very important, so you don't just fire up a bunch of servers and let them run idle all the time. But if you don't have the loads, you need to have a way to shut them down, put them away somewhere, spare the costs. So a few principles how to achieve this. First of all, your services must be self-contained. What does this mean? You have to explicitly define your dependencies and isolate them from your code. This means that your code, your application, is isolated from the outside system. You have everything in your package that can be deployed anywhere, and it contains everything it needs to run. We are very much fond of static linking, for example, in terms of C code. So we statically link all the libraries we use, and then we have one big package we can deploy, and there goes the transcoder. The problem with this is the GPL license. If you do deliver your applications to clients, and not just software as a service, but give them the application, then you must not do this stuff. You cannot do this stuff, because otherwise you have, unless you are willing to open source your stuff too, of course. As a part of IBM, we have to pay attention to this a lot more than back in the startup days, but luckily we didn't mess up too much, so we don't have to change too much now. And the other thing is, do not rely on packages being installed on any sort of system. Make sure that it gets there with your deployment. For example, if you use curl or like from a PHP code, you use image magic. It can be there or cannot be there. You cannot know it unless you deploy it with your application. And the other important concept is disposability, which means a process should be able to start and stop at a moment's notice without any further issues. So fast startup and graceful shutdown. Finish the last request and die. All your processes should follow this pattern. You should be able to achieve this with sending simple signals to a process. And you must be able to handle unexpected deaths of a process. So if a process started to work on a specific request or processing a specific job and dies unexpectedly in the middle of it, you must have some queue backend which will be able to serve the same job to a next process to handle it. It must not get lost. Then there's backing services. I took this image from the site called 12factor.net. You should check it out. They also list very good principles. Some of my ideas are taken from there too. So backing services are basically any services your application consumes as an external resource. It is anything that is required for application to operate. A couple of examples are shown here, like the database, like the Twitter API, or Amazon S3, or it can be an email service, or it can be any sort of thing which is not part of your application, but your application is dependent on it. You should treat them as attached resource. So you should specify their parameters in configuration. You should make no distinction between local and third-party services. So for development, you could use a MySQL database on localhost, but be able to swap it out easily to any other resource. You could also export your application services with port binding. So you assign a port to your service where you listen. You have your IP address and other services. Your other applications or someone else's other applications can use your application as an attached resource, as a backing service. And do stateless processes, which is important for disposability. So you don't do sticky sessions and all that stuff. The Linux process is a great model for this. It's been invented long ago, and there's nothing better since then. So the new thing is containers, which is basically a Linux process. So that's why I say a container is better than running a process in a virtual machine, because you don't have that much the overhead. You must know that you shouldn't share anything between your processes. So you can add concurrency as much as you want, because the processes won't interfere with each other. You can distribute different type of workload between different types of processes, and you can easily distribute them on any number of machines or virtual machines or whatever resources you have at hand, because you just fire up processes. And if one machine runs out of resources, you fire up the process on the next one. So how did we do in practice statelessness? We store everything in an external data source. So we don't keep application state in memory and stuff like that, but everything is in a backing resource. We do aggregations on this. We built a service called aggregator, which is basically a simple MapReduce service, which can query all the nodes of the same process, aggregate the response, and then return the aggregated answer to the requester. This is done with a CQ engine project. CQ engine is an open source library for JVM. You can add it to your application, and it can build in-memory NoSQL interface to your data. So your runtime data, I mean. So we have an application called Chandra based on that. I just quickly show you what it does. Just a second. So we have this tool. We use this to monitor our broadcasts. And yes, here we go. I just turned up the player because we don't need that. So this is the part that comes from aggregator real time. So we have like dozens of nodes. Viewers connect to each of them. But we are able to aggregate the current concurrent number real time and store them in a data store or display them here in a nice looking graph or use them for any type of monitoring. So, how do I close this? Back to the slides. Yeah, a few words about scalable data stores. So there's many NoSQL databases that claim to be scalable. We tested a lot of them. We found that you need to be very careful, and you need to do serious testing for your specific use case, because for some people Redis may be the nice choice, but it doesn't really scale well if your workload is write heavy, because you just cannot do that. Other option is, for example, Cassandra, or then you can use Aerospike. There's a lot of them, but not all of them fits every solution. And in the end, we ended up that we use basically all of them for different use cases. And yes, so if you have an application that's self-contained, disposable, stateless, and share nothing architecture, then you have to add an API layer for communication between these applications, and you have microservices. Of course, this means that from a great spaghetti code, you moved all your services to small services, you moved the dependency management to external dependency management. But you have to be warned about that. This does not spare you the complexity. This just moves it to another layer. You will not have a great bunch of spaghetti code. You will have a great bunch of spaghetti services. So you have to be careful when doing microservices. We did this. We ended up with hundreds of microservices, all depending on each other. And then we ended up that, OK, we just cannot make the modifications as easily as you should be able to in a microservice architecture, because they were so interdependent. So I don't have a solution for that so far. But we started to move back a bit and group things together again. Of course, to operate all this, you need to have very good monitoring. You must have collect all metrics that you have. You must generate metrics, of course, first, but then collect it. There's a couple of tools for that, Graphite, New Relic, Grafana. I didn't list it there, but we use that also. Your applications should also be self-aware, so you should be able to query your application for its state, for its health. It should be able to do self-checks and all that stuff. We maintain a cluster state in Zookeeper and Console. Console is maintaining the services for service discovery, and Zookeeper, for example, maintains a list of running instances for load balance and stuff like that. And we do our own scaling decisions, and we have our own scaling logic for different parts of the application stack. So we can, of course, monitor the capacity amount. You can just see, okay, we have only 10% free capacity left, just fire up a bunch of nodes. Or you can check the graph and see its derivative, see how quickly it grows or decreases, and decide based on that. Or there can be a self-aware application which requests new nodes. We use all of them. Here's a dashboard. We have dozens of these. We do them with a tool called dashing. And the graphs come from Graphite. There's the alerts and some other widgets. Every team has one of these, because it's put on big screens next to their tables. Every team has one relevant for their application. So they can monitor their application and they can operate their application. A few words about load balance quickly. So load balancing is to distribute workloads across multiple resources. I'm sure you know that. You can do it basically via these two methods. Either you use DNS service, so the same hostname points to different IP depending on the load balancing decision, or you have an API which you can query for where should the request go. Or you can do this in the application. In that case, you have a single entry point for the application, which must be high availability and high capacity entry point, and then it could proxy the requests to the certain nodes. Load balancing can be done based on application load on any given node, for example, or some application state in Zookeeper. We do that a lot. And then you can have resource policies. So for example, we have separate pools for different customer levels. So those customers who pay the most are separated from everyone else in order to keep them separated from sudden workload increases on other parts of the stack. So if you are a high profile customer and you have your high profile event, you can be assured that no random broadcasts will interfere with your event because of this suddenly increasing workload. You need to separate your services. We do rate limiting, which means that any service can accept a given number of requests per second. If there's more of that, we either scale up the service or discard the remaining one. This is because you must admit that failure is inevitable. So your nodes will die, your servers will die, your hard drives will die, all that stuff happens. You cannot do anything about that. So you need to protect your components from other failing components. For this, there's a pattern called circuit breaker. It's also not a new concept. There's a nice library from Netflix for that called Hystrix, which basically does this, that it stops cascading failure, so the service that's hit badly can recover. It provides an intermediate layer between the request and the application and returns requests as failure until the application recovers. So this achieves service decoupling, and they can communicate asynchronously with message queues. Yeah, and in the end, a bit of how we do deployment. This is a long-going process. We are in the middle of it. What the basic idea is, we want to automate all the things so that teams just push a button, application is deployed and working, and everybody's happy. We started out with using Chef and virtual machines. We still do that for a couple of services. It's quite good. You just specify the recipes and you fire up the virtual machines and then deploy your code with Chef. But it's a bit clumsy these days. There's better options. As I said, containers are better than virtual machines. They start up quicker, they are easier to deploy, easier to dispose of. So we started using Docker. And then we started moving on for immutable deployment, which means to scratch Chef from that picture and then have your containers built in advance and just fire up them on demand. We came up with the environment concept using Docker, Kubernetes, and Rancher on top of it. I will show an illustration about that in just seconds. But I want to let you know that there's one important thing you have to think about is that there might be some tasks which you must handle before shutting down a container or shutting down a virtual machine. For example, typical one of these is moving away remaining logs. So if you do a lot of logging for debugging, which you should, of course, most likely they are written locally and collected by some service. You need to have some time on shutdown to allow these logs to be transferred unless you lose data. And there might be some other tasks like this. For example, in a real-time transcoding use case, before you can stop a transcoder, which is transcoding a stream, you need to fire up another transcoder and confirm that the transcoding of the stream is started there. So you can now stop the first one. Stuff like that. So you need to be aware of this in shutdown scripts. So this is how we use Docker, Kubernetes, and Rancher together right now. This slide is from Rancher, it's not mine, but it illustrates the concept nicely. So we use Rancher to deploy Kubernetes environments. A Kubernetes environment is a bunch of machines which contains of worker nodes. Kubernetes orchestrates them and distributes the application workload by launching pods. Pod is a bunch of containers. So, for example, if you have a couple of applications that always run together, you can have a container for each of them and then group them together in a pod. And then you can fire up these pods on the nodes. So it's this orchestration is done by Kubernetes, and we have separate Kubernetes environments for same type of applications or different type of applications. This can be very useful, and these are completely separated from each other. So you can just fire up as many of them as you want, and they will not interfere with each other. And a few extras before I'm done. So we added a couple of extra debugging features. I highly recommend you do as much as possible of these. We added a central log collecting layer. Every log is collected into the central place. We process them with Logstash, and then we have a Kibana dashboard. And you can use this for monitoring, debugging, all that stuff. And we, since we do JVM, we could add consoles to access the JVM in real time. We do it with a closure REPL read, eval, print loop in case of closure applications. In case of Java applications, we added a JavaScript console with runtime capabilities. And then, of course, we can runtime configure with environment all our services. And we have a scaling API, which is good to mask all cloud providers from the application. So this Rancher stack can, in theory, run on anything, basically any cloud provider or any bunch of servers you gave it to them. And we wanted to hide the fact that we use AWS or we use SoftLayer or whatever provider do we use. We wanted to mask that fact from the development DevOps side, from the Rancher side. So there's a scaling API in between which integrates these cloud providers. And if globally we are running out of capacity, it's able to get us more resources from a cloud provider based on cost decisions and political decisions. For example, now that we are part of IBM, we prefer to use SoftLayer because they are also part of IBM and stuff like that. But the Rancher deployment or any sort of virtual machine deployment doesn't have to care about this. This is masked by the scaling API. So that's all about what I wanted to tell you. Here's a couple of links. I will share the slides so you can check them out. I highly recommend the first two of these, but the rest is also useful. And so we have some time for questions.
Hello. Did you use microservices from the start of your startup, or did you break down monolithic application later?
No. Yeah. So
because I read about stories that doing microservices from the start usually doesn't turn out well.
So yeah, we didn't use microservices from the start, and we still don't use microservices everywhere. So it's like we are in process of breaking down a monolithic application, not one monolithic application, but several ones. So we started out with big monolithic applications for the website, for the streaming server, for everything. And then we started breaking them up. There's a couple of components we break up in too many small microservices. That's where we realized that there should be a balance with that. So just don't go too far with that. But yes, we are not done with this. There's still many monolithic parts which we have to break down. Other question?
Yeah. Hi. You've mentioned NoSQL databases and how well will they scale or not scale depending on your specific use case. Can you quickly mention a couple of those you've tried and why they didn't work for you and the one you currently use and why it does good for you? Thank you.
Yeah, okay, sure. So let's start with Redis. We still use Redis in a bunch of places, but the case with Redis is that it scales very well for reads, but if you have a very big number of writes coming in, then its architecture does not support it after a certain level, because it doesn't really have a stable multi-master solution. At least last I checked, it might have changed since then, but last year it didn't have. Then there's Aerospike. Aerospike is very, very efficient in terms of scaling up and down very quickly. And it supports any number of concurrent reads and also reads and writes. So it's very good. But we found in our testing that during the process of adding or removing a node, the returned answer is incomplete. So if you use it for some use case where consistency is important, then you cannot use Aerospike unless you don't use the scaling features but fire up a bunch of nodes and you use it like that. So that's why we don't use Aerospike. Then we had experimented with a couple of less known ones, VaultDB and ResyncDB. We didn't use them because they weren't mature enough. And we ended up with Cassandra for the high workload use cases. The thing with Cassandra is that we tried Cassandra 4 years ago and then ditched it. And then we tried Cassandra 2 years ago and then we ditched it. And we tried Cassandra this year and now we found that it works. So it reached the maturity that we require. In the early days, the problems with Cassandra was around adding and removing nodes. They took a long time, like hours, which was unacceptable for us. And also that it wasn't really well protected against developer foolishness. So you could write queries that would bring your Cassandra cluster down. They did fix these issues. So if you ask me now, I would recommend Cassandra for high workloads. And then we also checked out MongoDB. We ended up not using it for some non-technical reasons, so I wouldn't go in that. Basically, that's all. Other questions? Okay, thank you very much then.